Only go to Jerusalem, the city of the house of God. Pilgrim people, receive the Lord of the house of God. His name proclaims his praises, he's the blessed Lord of all. Countless millions sing his glory, answering his pilgrim call. On we go to Jerusalem, the city of the house of God. Pilgrim people, we see the
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
My dear brothers, today we pray for the intentions you already mentioned. Birthday of our brother John Paul. We wish him God's choicest blessings. We pray for brother Paulo's speedy recovery. And also we pray for each and every one of us, for our fidelity to God in following him. And today, 22nd July, we celebrate the Feast of St. Mary Magdalene. So far it was only a memorial, an obligatory memorial. But from today onwards it is celebrated as the feast. The Holy Father has raised it to a feast. I want to read to you the decree that was issued on 3rd June 2016 concerning this feast by the Holy See, by Robert Cardinal Sara, Prefect of the Congregation of Divine Worship and Discipline of Sacraments. The Church, both in the East and in the West, has always regarded Saint Mary Magdalene the first witness of the Lord's resurrection and the first evangelist, and with the greatest reverence has always honored her, although in diverse ways. Given that in our time the Church is called to reflect in a more profound way on the dignity of woman, on the new evangelization, and on the greatness of the mystery of divine mercy, it seemed right that the example of Saint Mary Magdalene might also fittingly be proposed to the faithful. In fact, this woman, known as the one who loved Christ and who was greatly loved by Christ and was called a witness of divine mercy by Saint Gregory the Great and an apostle of the apostles by Saint Thomas Aquinas, can now rightly be taken by the faithful as a model of women's role in the Church. Therefore, the Supreme Pontiff Pope Francis has established that from now on the celebration of Saint Mary Magdalene should be inscribed in the general Roman calendar with the rank of feast rather than memorial, as is presently the case. The new rank of celebration does not involve any change of the day on which the celebration itself takes place. And as for the liturgical text, the following is to be observed. The day dedicated to the celebration of Saint Mary Magdalene remains the same as it appears in the Roman calendar, that is 22nd July. The text to be used in the Mass and in the Divine Office remain the same as those contained in the Missal and in the Liturgy of the Hours on the day of the feast. with the addition in the missal of a proper preface attached to this decree. The only change in the liturgy is the new preface is given. It will be the responsibility of the conferences of bishops to translate the text of the preface into the vernacular language, so that having received the approval of the apostolic see, it can be used and in due time included in the next reprint of the Roman Missal, where according to particular law, Saint Mary Magdalene is legitimately celebrated on a different day, and as a solemnity, this day and rank remains as before. All things to the contrary, notwithstanding, from the Congregation for Divine Worship and the Discipline of Sacraments, 3rd June 2016, Solemnity of the Most Sacred Heart of Jesus. Robert Cardinal Sara, Prefect, Archbishop Arthur Roach, Archbishop Secretary. So this is the new decree that has been issued, raising what was in the liturgy only memoria into a feast. So the context is, as the Cardinal said, of course, as requested by the Pope, we are concerned about new evangelization and the greatness of the mystery of divine mercy. And especially she is a model, not only for priests and religious, but all the faithful. A woman known as the one who loved Christ and who was greatly loved by Christ. Saint Gregory called her witness of divine mercy. Saint Thomas Aquinas called her apostle of the apostles. So it's really fitting that we know this. We are aware of it. It was promulgated on the solemnity of the Most Sacred Heart of Jesus, 3rd June, last month, this year. I took a printout also of the unofficial translation of the preface. So such a wonderful person, a model for us. May she intercede for us, and may we be inspired to follow her example through the grace of this Eucharist. Let us feel sorry for all our sins and failures before we commence this Holy Mass. I confess to Almighty God and to my brothers and sisters that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask the Saviour of the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
On earth peace.
Only begotten Son, entrusted Mary Magdalene before all others with announcing the great joy of the resurrection. Grant, we pray, that through her intercession and example, we may proclaim the living Christ and come to see him reigning in your glory, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Tell us, Mary, say what thou didst see upon the way, the tomb the living did enclose. I saw the Christ's glory as he rose.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Saint John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
It was very early on the first day of the week and still dark when Mary of Magdala came to the tomb. She saw that the stone had been moved away from the tomb and came running to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one Jesus loved. "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb," she said, "and we don't know where they have put him." Mary stayed outside near the tomb, weeping. Then, still weeping, she stooped to look inside and saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been, one at the head, the other at the feet. They said, "Woman, why are you weeping?" "They have taken my Lord away," she replied, "and I don't know where they have put him." As she said this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there. Enough, she did not recognize him. Jesus said, "Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have taken him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will go and remove him." Jesus said, "Mary." She knew him then and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means master. Jesus said to her, Do not cling to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go and find the brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. So Mary of Magdala went and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, and that he had said these things to her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear brothers, one of my favorite saints, this Saint Mary Magdalene. Maybe I talked to you earlier about her, but doesn't matter. Once again repeating what I said, that you may be confirmed in your knowledge of Mary Magdalene. Traditionally, some people identify this Mary Magdalene with a woman described in Luke 7th chapter, the sinner woman in the house of Simon the Pharisee. Some others even thought that she is the woman caught in adultery, described in 8th chapter of Luke's Gospel. And yet others thought that she is also the sister of Martha, who is Mary of Bethany. But biblically, there doesn't seem to be any identification for this, though even Gregory the Great and some other important people in the church involved in these kind of identifications. What do we know about her from the Bible? First time we hear about her in Luke's Gospel, 8th chapter, in the context of the women disciples. Luke chapter 8, 1 to 3 refers to some of the women who followed Jesus. Among them is mentioned Mary Magdalene. And it is reported that Jesus cast out 7 demons from her. And what is the response of the women, especially Mary Magdalene? The response is, they served the Lord from their resources. The women, including Mary Magdalene, served the Lord from their resources. So that is the first message for us today. The Lord gave her health. The Lord gave her new life. The Lord restored her dignity. What is the response? Serving the Lord from her resources. Making use of her talents. Maybe she had some money. Maybe she could cook well. Maybe she can take care of the Lord's other needs. The Lord gave us life right from the time of our mother's womb up to this day. Good health, Christian formation. We could have been nobody. We are somebody thanks to the grace of God. Are we putting all our resources at the feet of the Lord to serve Him? That is the first question. Imitate Mary's example. We should not live half-hearted lives. Lives full of vitality, fruitfulness, surrender, dedication. That is Mary Magdalene. And then the second scene, Mary Magdalene appears repeatedly in the Gospels. All the 4 evangelists mention this particular point. All the evangelists mention this particular point when she is standing at the foot of the cross. Following the Lord till the very end. So I have repeated to you a number of times, well begun is often, but it is only often. Many are good beginners, but poor finishers. The enthusiasm of the first day doesn't last till the very end. Some are very enthusiastic in the minor seminary. Some others carry that enthusiasm to first year philosophy. By the time they become deacons, as lazy and lethargic as possible. Even in married life also that happens. Very, very affectionate, attentive, in the beginning of marriage or before the marriage, after 2 children are born, they don't respect each other. That should not be the case. Following till the very end. following till the very end. Keep alive that enthusiasm. That's the important. Every day, new day, Lord, give me enthusiasm. Give me cheerfulness. That should be our first prayer. Not simply going about just one more day. No, not like that. Following the Lord till the very end. The disciples ran away. This woman, Lord, you gave me everything. I want to be with you, even in your moments of sufferings. I am not able to do anything extraordinary. My presence shows my solidarity with you through presence. That is Mary Magdalene. But in Matthew's Gospel, there is another beautiful verse in the 27th chapter. After Jesus is buried, it is reported that Mary Magdalene and another Mary were sitting before the tomb. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, after the burial of Jesus, were sitting still before the tomb. What a wonderful scene. I recall the funerals I went, where people, so many people go for the burial to the cemetery. And then when the prayer will be over, we can put a handful of mud in the pit and then come away. That's what we will think. Think of the intense and immense love of Mary Magdalene. Even after the burial is over, sitting there, not wanting to go away from our Lord. Our Lord is everything for us. That is her intense love. Then, of course, the final passage from which we had our gospel reading today, Mary Magdalene going to the tomb on the third day, not finding the Lord, shocked, runs to the apostles, Peter and John, and then tells them, the body of the Lord is not there. She was waiting for the Sabbath to end early in the morning. She did not postpone her trip to the tomb. Early in the morning, wanting to do some anointing and show her respect. And then coming and reporting. Okay, I have told people concerned, I will remain at home. No. Then she returns to the tomb. We are told that John saw the empty tomb and believed. This woman remains there weeping. And today's gospel passage repeats at least 4 times the word weeping. She pours out her love through her tears to the Lord. And today's first reading says, my heart, my soul seeks the one whom I love. I found him, I found my beloved, seeking her Lord. Seeking her Lord. And then what happens? She thinks that there is the gardener. Well, in fact, Jesus was there. Sir, she says, if you had taken him away, tell me, now give the back the body of my Lord. I will carry him. What a woman can do, but a loving woman can do anything, everything for the woman she loves. That is Mary Magdalene. That is Mary Magdalene. Immediately, the gardener, Jesus, says, Mary, one word is enough. Just one word is enough. As I have been telling people, sometimes I get call from people whom I know for quite long, but I don't recognize them. So in order to not to displease them, I always say, from where you are speaking, did you go for Mass today, how was the homily, who celebrated the Mass, then I remember, then from this place, this person. Then only this is the way. That means that person's voice is not familiar. My relationship with that person is not so intimate, so intense. So in order not to asking, what is your name? Or sometimes I say, I don't hear you properly. Please tell me who is speaking, like that. Sometimes when I am not able to find out in 1 minute, then like that I say like that. Because I don't recognize the person. But her relationship is so close. One word is enough. If we love somebody, even a little moment, the blink of the eye also is enough. We know that that is the person who is coming. Rabboni, my master, holds on to him. The gospel says, she turned her heart. She turned once again. Second time, she turned. First time already she was turned, but only the body was turned. And the second time her heart was turned. Opening, welcome to the master. And then Jesus says, do not hold on to me like this. So every time we go to the chapel also, oh, you want to be here, don't hold on to me. Go, I send you with your mission. Go to your room and study. Go to your room and do your work. Go to the brothers and tell this. Go and do this job that has been assigned to you. Sending out with your mission after being with the Lord. We are with the Lord. We are sitting at the feet of the Lord. Not to be irresponsible, but to become more responsible and to give ourselves wholeheartedly for the mission which the Lord entrusts us with. Go and tell my brothers. My brothers, tell them that I sent you to them, that I have risen. Tell them that I have seen the Lord. Our whole occasion is that seminary is a time of being with the Lord. Going out telling people I have seen the Lord. And she was so close to the Lord. Every priest and religious has this vocation of Mary Magdalene. Being touched by the Lord, serving the Lord from their resources, following the Lord till the very end, seeking the Lord, listening to His word and recognize Him. My sheep hears my voice. And then being given a mission by the Lord, going out fulfilling the mission and telling the people I have seen the Lord. What an example for seminarians and priests, this great saint Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene. We have to tell the world that we have seen the Lord through word and deed. May the word of God really touch our hearts, and may the Eucharistic Lord, who gave this mission to Mary Magdalene, who invites us for a specific purpose, also give us the necessary generosity, courage, and perseverance in following Him very closely. Amen.
All things are thine, O Lord. We offer thee what we receive from thy hand. All things are thine, O Lord.
Brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of His name, for the good and good of all His holy Church.
Accept, O Lord, the offerings presented in commemoration of Saint Mary Magdalene, whose homage of charity was graciously accepted by your only begotten Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord. Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, whose mercy is no less than His power to preach the gospel to everyone through Christ our Lord. In the garden He appeared to Mary Magdalene, who loved Him in life, who witnessed His death on the cross, who sought Him as He lay in the tomb, who was the first to adore Him when He rose from the dead, and whose apostolic duty was honored by the apostles, so that the good news of life might reach the ends of the earth. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, earth is full of your glory, glory fills the heavens too. Sing to Him, Hosanna.
Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time He was betrayed and He entered willingly into His passion, He took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, He took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, He gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of His death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Bernard Morris, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. We pray especially for our beloved brother John Paul. Bless him abundantly as he thanks you for the gift of life and Christian faith. Give speedy recovery to Brother Paulus. Bless each and every one here at St. Peter's, that they may all serve you from their resources, follow you till the very end, seek you and recognize you, and announce to the world that they have seen your loving Son, Jesus, who is risen. May we, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with St. Joseph, our beloved spouse, with St. Anne and Joachim, her beloved parents, with St. Mary Magdalene, with St. Peter and all the other blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
Mary Magdalene sought the Lord earnestly, with perseverance. We need to pray also like her to the Father, who will provide all our needs. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Peace be with you.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are we who are called to his banquet.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us, and we remember the promise in the tongue who come in faith and forgive.
Oh.
The love of Christ impels us so that those who live may live no longer for themselves, but for Him who died for them and was raised. Let us pray. May the holy reception of your mysteries, Lord, instill in us that persevering love with which Saint Mary Magdalene clung resolutely to Christ, her Master, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
No one can leave us an island, journeying through life alone. Since the cross of thy mother, Jesus gave us his own. Be with us, Mary, along the way. Guide every step we take. Lead us to Jesus, your loving Son. Come with us.